the early count.
And you can see it. That was off to the side. Who's there?
Sorry, that's Peter.
So I think, why don't we start? So I'm going to call the Finance Committee to order. Tonight's meeting of the Finance Committee is being recorded for RCTV Live. It's Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33, but if you heard me say that, you're watching one of those. Videographer for tonight's meeting is Rob. Before we get on to kind of FinCom business, I know that the superintendent and the town manager each have an announcement that, or a discussion they'd like to start. So, John, you want to start?
Sure. If you are not a family of school-age children in the public schools, we do not have school tomorrow.
Oh, this the first announcement?
It wasn't on TV yet, though.
We already sent it up.
Oh, yes. We wanted to be the first.
We just sent it up.
We could start that special.
Awesome. All right. Bob?
And I want to let residents and businesses know that tomorrow Town Hall will be closed, the Reading Public Library will be closed, and the Senior Center will be closed all day. And importantly, MassDOT, and just an hour ago the governor announced that really motorists should stay off the roads tomorrow as much as possible. The latest forecast is 8 to 14 inches, but there's a possibility of 18 to 24 inches depending on how things go. Snow at its worst is going to be 2 to 3 inches per hour with 30 to 50 mile an hour winds. You will not be able to see if you're driving. DPW has sent out a reminder, but just to remind everyone, if tomorrow's your rubbish day, please don't put the rubbish out. It'll be picked up on Friday. And if your rubbish day's Friday, please put it out on Saturday. And lastly, I just want to read something in from the police chief. Due to the impending snowstorm, the Reading parking ban will be in effect from 7 a.m. February 9th until 7 a.m. February 10th. There is no parking on streets or public ways per order of the chief of police. So thank you.
Thank you.
Just got that phone call.
Me too. Text message, phone call.
Awesome.
I got the
full disclosure for everyone. Peter Leidecker is on the phone. You see his name tag in front of the phone. He is actually on the phone right now. So if you hear a voice from the box, it's okay. So I sent out a little bit of an update to the agenda for tonight. I think there are a lot of things that we want to talk about, but one of the things, let me just kind of give a couple of kind of ground rules. One is I don't anticipate any voting action tonight because we don't have a budget or anything else in front of us to vote on at this time. But I think it's very important that we talk through some of the issues surrounding the potential use of free cash. I know the town manager last night at the Board of Selectmen's meeting, three of us were there, if you saw it on TV or otherwise, has a very interesting idea in terms of how to support more of the town activities kind of inside the budget. I did send it out to you folks. I apologize. I printed it out myself. It's a little light. Uh-huh. Just, saving on ink, I guess. But in your packet tonight is a copy of it, so you can see it a little bit more. It's probably more helpful. And so what I was hoping we could do tonight, first of all, is kind of talk through a little bit of the discussion that initially came from a school committee motion, and then the budget that they've now submitted related to potentially getting more money into the budget from free cash or stabilization funds. And I think it's important that we kind of talk that through, because at the financial forum, let me give you kind of my take on it, and then I'd like to kind of go around the room and let everybody else do that as well. At the last financial forum, we did talk through very specifically a lot of the activities that were going on in town. We were aware that there was likely a litigation settlement at that time, and roughly the dollar amount magnitude of that. And from my perspective, we had a pretty good idea of all the kind of activities surrounding. At that time, we took a vote on how much free cash we thought could be used to support the operating budget for fiscal 18. From my perspective, I don't think things have changed really from that. And when we did our vote and we looked at kind of how much free cash would be sustainable, we started with some high numbers, some low numbers. We kind of came to this, you know, about a 1.2 number that seemed to make sense. I guess from my perspective, as I said, I don't think things have really changed. That number still makes sense in terms of how much we can support the fiscal 18 operating budget. That says two things for me. One is, you know, is there an opportunity to have a large additional infusion of free cash? I don't think that that's fiscally prudent. Second is, how do we support the services that the town is asking for? And again, my perspective, I don't think free cash is the source of that. It's certainly not a sustainable source, no matter what. And there really only is one solution, and that is to get more revenues into the town. That's the only sustainable solution that we have. There are some short-term requests, some short-term needs that are going on. And again, the town manager has a proposal on what may come from that and how that can work. At this point, not all the information is here or in front of us, and probably won't be for, you know, a few more weeks at least. But I think it's important we start the discussion, find out where everybody's coming from, and we may hear some different discussions on kind of how that's going to go. Jean, do you want to call to order, or do you need four?
For being a few minutes late.
No, no worries.
Do I need to call to order? 1, 2, 3.
You need to get to four. Sorry. Okay. Sorry. We'll keep going. So let's see what else. So that was kind of discussion on from my perspective on free cash and where we are on the budget. At the last financial forum, just a few weeks ago, we talked a little bit about kind of where the free cash position is. And I've heard, I've had a lot of questions sent to me about, well, you know, what's going on, what's really in there, where is it going to be, why don't we use it, is it a big number? So again, I think from my perspective, I look at, we have total reserves in the town right now, largely in two accounts, one called free cash, which is certified by the state and unencumbered, and we have a general stabilization fund. We've also had some discussions about creating additional stabilization funds. But at the end of the day, there's some available amount of resource that can be used to support emergency activities and things that are largely unforeseen. That money, I believe, really is for special project kinds of activities, emergencies, really unforeseen things. Litigation probably would fit into that as one of the good categories. And it shouldn't be viewed as a source of really anything else. The other question I've heard is, boy, it's a big number. We showed a number at the last financial forum showing that it's probably about 8.5% of the of revenue, essentially, in fiscal 18. Depending on what you assume for regeneration, that's kind of the starting number that it's at. We established a policy, I believe last year, of 7%, which is raising it up from 5% before, but we established 7%. As we looked around at other towns in the area, there are towns that have very substantial balances. I don't think it's a bad thing to be holding a reasonable amount of cash. And again, from my perspective, just kind of want to reiterate, I'm thinking that to be very, you know, fiscally prudent, that 1.1, 1.2 number is about the right number. And I still continue to support that personally as being about the right number. What I'd suggest is, why don't we kind of talk around a little bit, just get perspective on kind of where people are coming from, because I think it's important to share this with essentially town meeting at the end of the day, but also as the selectmen are in deliberations, as the school committee's in deliberations, kind of be good to kind of understand where we might be thinking as it relates to support to town meeting.
I mean, obviously want to discuss it more tonight, understand a little bit more behind kind of what the proposal is, and I've seen it, I've read through, you know, the materials we got last, I would agree with you, but not much has changed in terms of where we thought we would be and where we are. We spent a lot of time over the last year talking about an override, talking about what would happen if the override didn't come, and that's exactly where we are. I'm very excited to see that there's a potential opportunity, even if it's short term, you know, that we can hopefully bridge a gap and get something done. I have a fear that that's going to impact and potentially further delay the next override when it comes, but to some extent that's irrelevant. If a hard scrub found that there is a little bit more money, then there is, and that should be used, and that's great news for the short term. It becomes a communication issue to educate folks on the future and what that means and how that, you know, plays out the next couple of years. That's kind of my main fear, but yes, all in all, I kind of look at it and say we are more or less exactly where we thought we were going to be, so.
I see two separate topics here. One is the use of additional free cash, and the other being the letter from the town manager that came out last night. As far as free cash, I'd agree with Paul. We're not in a, nothing has really changed. Using it, using additional free cash to stop that gap or bridge that gap doesn't solve our greater fiscal issue that we have now. And we've been advised repeatedly by the town manager that it's not, and we know that it's not a prudent fiscal policy. So I agree. I don't think much has changed. As far as the developments from last night, I understand the town manager legally has to present a balanced budget. I'm just concerned about the fact that we have, you know, in the almost 2 years that I've been a part of, FinCom said that there is no more money. And yet every year we say, oh, but wait, we have been able to scrap together some additional funds. And my concern is that for people that are not as into this minor details of where these funds are coming from, that the only thing that they are seeing is somehow we managed to make it work. And so what I have heard complaints about is lack of transparency overall and mismanagement, which I don't necessarily agree with, but there's a perception issue here. And so every time there's a gap and every time there's a need for additional funds, we somehow manage to find it. And yet for a year and a half, we have been saying, there's no more money, there's no more places to make this up. And yet it happens again. So an override failed. We've said, this is it. These are the positions we're going to lose across the town. And now we're saying, oh, but wait, we can now save these positions, which I want to do as well. But it doesn't make us look like we're being honest with the town. And that is a very big concern to me, because in my opinion, we are losing credibility every time we do this.
Mark.
Yes, please.
I think John would also probably like to speak. I think it's really important to remind FinCom and the public, significant cuts were made this year, even though one tiny cut was avoided, tiny relative to the cuts that were made. You know, the town eliminated 7.5 FTEs. I don't really know what the school number is.
10.9.
Between us, we cut, I don't know, $1.5 million probably.
People are actually leaving these positions with the exception of one.
Correct. So it's, I agree with your concern, and sound bites can do many things in this world. But the basic fact does remain, both sides did significant cuts. They didn't do as much as maybe they would have had to do.
But that doesn't change it.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. And I don't want to discount that, because I fully recognize that there are many cuts across the board. But it also raises the issue of other departments have also had to cut staff. And there's a concerted effort to save the schools. And I can understand why, having a child in the schools here. But it's still this arrangement, while saving some positions, doesn't address our larger issue, which is that we still need an override. And if this makes us last a year, 6 months or a year, or whatever that timeline is, will the override pass the next time we put it forward? Because those people that voted no are going to say, well, you fixed it last time. Why can't you do it again this year? And that just keeps happening. And the cliff is just getting that much higher.
Yeah. And I think to be clear to the point that was just raised, the cuts have been very substantial over the last multiple years.
Yes.
The finding of money, I don't see how we could possibly find money to stop serious cuts from taking place, period, this year. It isn't there. So in terms of credibility, the money isn't there. That's what we've said. We're all there also. Now it's an issue of, are there nickels, dimes? Are there changes in policies that might be able to have an impact?
Well, I would like to answer your question, but I think probably the FinCom would go first. But you asked, you sort of said, you know, people talking about what's changed. So I would like an opportunity to address that, but I don't
yeah,
think
I want
to
go around the room first.
But every person.
Yeah, and to be clear, what hasn't changed is the financial picture has not changed. We haven't found a significant additional revenue. We haven't incurred significant additional costs, meaning that the cuts that were forecast to have to take place, that's exactly where we are. That's what I mean, what hasn't changed.
I think something has changed, but I'd like to wait my turn.
Thank you for waiting. Eric.
Just a couple comments picking up on what Vanessa was talking about with the override, then we'll talk about free cash. I think the characterization that bothers me, and none of us are making it, but it could be the argument that comes back from people who might be against the override, would be they found the money. I don't think anybody found the money. I don't think Bob opened a drawer yet and opened before and found a pile of cash. As I read your memo, there could be other cuts that are made, and there already have been a lot of cuts. So it's not as if we found the money. I think it's incumbent upon all of us as we engage in conversations in the community to reframe the issue. When someone says, oh, you fixed it, we found it, we didn't fix it, we didn't find it, we made different decisions. With regard to free cash, I'm firmly in alignment with some of the comments that have been made already. I see free cash as one-time issues. The TLT litigation is circumstances, maybe capital spending, you know, decisions that are made mid-year if the funds are available, and that's really what I see it for. I went back and watched the tape of our finance committee meeting in November, partially because that was game seven of the World Series. I'm a huge Cleveland Indians fan, so I was only half there. Basing that on what I think free cash is for. I'm basing that on the town accountant's suggestion that $1 million she was comfortable with as a regeneration. And I was also struck by the town manager's comment, which I felt was a little forceful, more forceful than what I generally hear from the town manager. I think he characterized it as a reckless to dip too much into free cash, to go beyond, say that. I wonder if during our conversation it might be a good idea to revisit the rationale of the 7% decision. I don't think, so if it's at 8.5%, I don't think our rationale is we want to be at 7. I want to go back and revisit that a little bit. I don't think the idea is if we're over 7, we have room to play and can spend down to 7. I don't think that was it.
Mm-hmm.
And so again, as we frame this conversation, frame this issue, particularly with those who say, well, you're above it, you've got room.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that that's necessarily the intention or the policy. It might make sense to make that
proposed in the fall and that we're talking about now, even though at the time I was a proponent of using more free cash because we're using less than half of what we used last year to balance the budget.
Mm-hmm.
But I do see that as budgets get tighter, regeneration's tougher. And the path we're even talking about going down is basically taking away from regeneration.
Right.
So
right.
That guarantee of a million plus regeneration with a tight budget and with hoping to get some savings here and there, they're gonna be needed to meet the expenses. We're not gonna necessarily get that back in regenerations. So for those reasons, I'm comfortable with the figure we ended up going with, which again was less than what I originally recommended. I also have a very different attitude on using free cash for one-time kind of items versus supporting an operating budget. You know, one can't be sustainable and the other one, you're very consciously using it one time and don't expect to see it again. So for one-time issues, for example, if we have a discussion about the science curriculum, to me that's sort of a different discussion and I'm more comfortable with going into that. The third point I want to make, which we've talked about some, and I don't want to discuss it so much tonight that we come to a vote or something, but I'd really like to put on the agenda after the budget cycle, and that is, do we have the free cash in the right place? If we're going to have a policy of 7%, but take significant action if it gets to 5%, it seems prudent to me to take that 5% and put it in a stabilization fund, just as you manage your home accounts where you say, okay, I've really got to hold on to this, so I'm going to put this in a savings account, but I'll leave this in the checking, or I'll put this in a CD and I'll put this in the savings. I think we want to look at that 5% as very sacred and put it in a stabilization fund that takes 2/3 vote at town meeting. And I think optically it's the right thing too, so it doesn't look like free cash. So I'd really like to put that on the agenda for a subsequent meeting.
David.
So it's hard to argue with everything that's been said, right? I mean, anybody who's watching, understanding the free cash, we can't use the free cash. It's, and then on the other side, there's the optics of it, using it, and as you were saying, people who believes, unfortunately, don't believe that people who are sitting in these positions know what they're doing sometimes, that they're doing their best. This town is as efficient as it could be. They're going to see it as optics and say, oh, look, we were right. There was money. They were able to come up with money. But I like to concentrate on something that we haven't discussed, which is the reputation. You know, working for a corporation, reputation can overnight be destroyed. Doesn't work the same way for a municipal or for a town. It can take a year or a couple of years for reputation to turn around. But and a school system, it takes... And you tell us how many years or decades it takes to actually build a good school system and get that reputation. Within a year or two, damaging the reputation of this town school, it's reckless.
Mm-hmm.
It's reckless for all of us who live here, whether we have kids who go to the school or not. Because, you know, indirectly things, and I don't want to sound like a half-empty glass type of guy because I'm not that type of guy. But it does lead to more crime. It does lead to more, less safety and so forth. So I'm torn. I'm torn in sense of, you know, do we step in and save the reputation of this town? But then we're left with the optics that, hey, look, there was money. They did come up with a way of doing this, and we're not going to solve the long-term challenges that are ahead of us. I'll leave it with that.
Mark.
So, obviously, last, but so I echo a lot of what was at the table. I'll just say I am comfortable with the 1.1, 1.2 that we decided before. Again, I was with Paula originally saying we should use more free cash, and I recognize that, but I hindsight of this one for me is 2020. I realize it was the right move, and I think in part it got people to engage in this process of looking at the budget, you know, and people really have latched on to that. So I'm a little less worried about the optics for that reason. I think that you have an audience and you have a captive audience at this point because they're kind of waiting on every word that every town committee makes, every decision they make. So I think the optics thing could be cushioned by the engagement, which I think is great. So I'm definitely in favor of a lot of maybe kind of making up for one-time things like the science curriculum, like been talked about. I think that's a great use of free cash because, you know, you can't turn the clock back for those type of items. So those are what I would say is a quick, hey, we'll just fix this problem real quick, but we really didn't fix the problem, folks, so let's pay attention here. So generally, I'm relatively comfortable. I think that we should, as a committee, discuss kind of where the free cash is held and how we view it, and do we put it into sort of a safer keeping place, like you said, with a two-thirds vote. I would like to discuss some of those things, but in general, I think that's the view.
All right, yeah.
All right. So to what you said earlier, Mark, I absolutely agree that a stabilization fund is for emergencies, unforeseen emergencies, and this deplorable state of finances that we find ourselves in is not an emergency or unforeseen. And then with regard to the free cash, I was comfortable with the 1.2, but I do recall from that financial forum, Bob cautioning us then that was beyond what may have even been prudent. So to go beyond that, particularly if we're going to look for a solution where we are going to be regenerating less, as Paula said, would not be wise. That being said, I am certainly very mindful of the fact that while we're looking for a solution to get us through the next year, there are, as well as long-term solutions, there are kids in school today who can't wait for those long-term solutions, who need to, get their education started with their foreign languages so that they're going to be prepared on a path for college, and I'm very, very well aware of that. So I do really appreciate the creative thinking that has gone into trying to find a solution. And I think to Eric's point, that was a very good one, that this was not because new money was found, but because if this is the solution that is chosen, it's because other cuts had to have been made. And I think that's an important point to make as kind of a competing narrative to what seems to be out there to a certain extent, that the language to try to encourage people to vote for the override was merely scare tactics, and that this budget that's been presented, they're not really going to have these kinds of cuts, like not really, because they always find money and well, we may have had a decision was made to make other painful cuts. So
Peter on the phone. Let me just make one other comment, if I could, and then we can open for public discussion. We've talked all about, I think, kind of where we are for this year and the fact that we have a structural problem that has to be addressed that requires additional revenue, and the only near-term source of that is an override. At the Selectmen's meeting last night, I think John Halsey had a good phrase that I'll borrow from him, which is that, this is exactly what Prop 2.5 was meant to do, was to force this kind of a discussion. And to realize that you can't do it, it's going to take more, but you need to have a discussion about it. So I think that's exactly where we are. A little bit outside of kind of just the near-term discussion, the one thing that troubles me is that if we start making fundamental changes to the town services and decreasing them, at some point the repercussions are beyond just the individual departments having to do less. At some point, having schools that aren't of the same caliber because they can't afford to do all the programs, not having the right level of public safety, starts to impact potentially housing values in town and desirability of the community. And I think that we also have a role to step in at that point and say, that's not an okay solution either, and that things need to be done. And again, I applaud the near-term discussion that we're gonna have, and I'll let Bob go into more detail, cause I don't have any more detail, but it's gonna be tough to get to the kind of number we're talking about, and may not be possible to get to that whole number, and may require, in fact, going in front of town meeting to request some money. In fact, it wouldn't shock me at all if we found ourselves in that situation. And as strongly as I came out this evening on absolutely it can happen, I think the process that we're gonna go through of finding what is possible, however little it may be, however much it might be, is critical. It goes to credibility, it goes to process, and it goes to the fact that the town needs to have additional revenue to do what its residents are expecting. With that, let me open to public comment.
Great, thank you, Mark. You may have on the school committee. So I think I agree with people who on the surface would say, you know, nothing changed from what we tried to tell people would happen when we were in, you know, August and September. But before we started the FY18 budget process, and John and his team start that very early, probably in July, I've been on the school committee for 10 years. This has been the most arduous budget that we have ever asked a superintendent and staff to put together. But before that arduous budget, the last 2 years, we cut $1.494 million. Those were not easy budgets either. So we go into that in this situation. We tell people, we were transparent, we were detailed, we told people this is what will happen. But what changed when the override failed was that we were now in the midst of the reality of the budget, not a piece of paper that says this is what the budget will be, right? So, you know, now we are in a place where we have gone through every detail. You've been at many of our meetings. Paul has been at just about every single one of our meetings. And you know the fine-tooth comb that we've been through our budget. You know what we've put John through going back and give us another view. Answer the 92nd or 93rd question that we've had, right? We've been through all of that. And we've cut $813,405. That's 10.9 actual real people. I don't mean this in a negative way. The town has had the ability to mostly cut positions that they already had held back. So I understand that, but we had one position in that count. We've increased the fees. This solution that Mr. Robinson came up with, which I think is an excellent solution, and maybe it was not thought of as such an excellent solution previously, is a solution to get at what David highlighted about doing, if we were to do that cut, if we have to make that cut, it's going to do structural damage. It's gonna undermine a program that will take us years to recover. The damage that it does when you cut that level of staff to teachers takes years to recover. We saw, I think in the early 2000s, before our override or right on our override, Andover was a similar situation. It took them like 4 years to recover their teaching staff because of the damage that does. So I was maybe when we put our proposal forward and we voted our school committee budget and we all supported that, I think I was actually a little bit more hopeful that this would be supported, that the use of free cash for this, I think the science curriculum is sort of a little different. I always looked at both of these a little differently. But I think that I felt that it would be, considered, I know that the finance community considered fairly. And just as you have your responsibility to fiscal responsibilities and your policies, we have our policies. And I absolutely feel like our policy and our commitment to education and the children and the students is what drove us to say, we're not going to make this cut. We have to try at least one more thing to see if the town will support this. And I personally never felt like an April override was a good idea. I was very outspoken about that. I just in my mind said, would the town just support this one more, this $438,000, so that we don't have to do this? So I think we did the best that we could. We have turned over every stone. I believe it was a split committee vote. We tried to add another $30,000, right, Mrs. Doxer, with increasing another fee, right? We tried to save another 0.6 of a teacher, I believe. Right?
Yep.
And add another $30,000. And the vote didn't pass. It was, you know, we've tried everything. So whether it's a stone or a couch cushion or a quarter or a penny, okay,
need them all.
Right. I'm the queen of couch cushion. $450 when my parents left me and left the couch. So we're, you know, we're good at that. And I feel to some extent that, it's the school committee's budget, by the way, now, not the superintendent, okay? The school committee the superintendent did everything we asked of him with his team and delivered the least worst of the worst recommendation that we could, and we voted it, so it's our budget now. And I don't know that I've read Bob's letter a couple times. I don't know that I fully understand exactly where we are, except that I guess my understanding is that we're going to go forward. We will not have to cut the teachers.
The seven teachers.
We will not have to cut the seven teachers and eliminate our middle school language program and the English sixth grade ELA. And we will march through this year as we execute our responsibilities on the committee, and we march through this year, and we will look for opportunities to ask the superintendent or for us to, I don't know. Again, more pennies out of the couch cushions. I'm not sure where that's going to be, but we'll do that. But when it's all said and done, and the town manager indicated that the municipal departments would do that also to help support the $438,000. When it's all said and done, I guess, and if we cannot find all of that, then I guess we're going to be asking FinCom and town meeting again at some later point. But I just really, not everyone in this room has been through the CARE campaign and the Building Pride campaign and the Yes for Reading campaign. I was trying to think what the other school campaigns were called, but Reading Pride. So I hope that when we get to next year, people aren't thinking we just found the money. This is the worst situation that this town has been in, and it's absolutely going to affect everyone and property values. So I hope that we can eliminate from our own language the finding money,
mm-hmm.
because there's always a cost.
Mm-hmm.
At this point, there is always a cost, right? We're at $2.2 million with these cuts. There's always a cost. We didn't find anything. We give up something every time, and we've done it. And in the schools, the people that feel the impact are the students and our staff.
One point I want to highlight that you touched upon earlier, which it's preaching to the choir with this set, but both Dr. Doherty and Bob very clearly at the end of the summer stated, this is what it's going to mean.
Mm.
In black and white, this is what it's going to mean. And as we all know, people don't engage until it personally affects them. And so it's critical that we keep this engagement up from the people. And Bob, that was a really good point you made last night, that we have open town meeting slots at this point, and the last day to get papers in is next week. So we've got to keep the engagement going, because just as we have found over the last couple of years frustrating when people who don't know any history say, how can we go into an override? How did we do these debt exclusions? Why did we do the library? And you're like, oh my goodness, do you know how much we tried to highlight? We knew. We all discussed it. We tried to make it as public as possible. So critical to keep as much engagement in the town as going. So of all these people who are engaged right now, I just hope it keeps engaged because we need it.
Yes.
I want to mention something that probably isn't going to be very popular, but the override did fail. And I recognize the work that the town manager and the superintendent have done. And I don't know if that appreciation for all of that work in the school committee came off earlier when I spoke. So I do want to applaud their efforts. However, the voting population of this town voted, and they made it very clear what their priorities were. I may not be in an agreement with that vote, but, and I agree that the values of homes in a town, especially like ours, are so closely related to our school system. But we need to recognize that the greater financial issue that we have here cannot be resolved by this wonderful nickel and diming that and these efforts that have been made. And that can only take us so far. There is a much greater issue. And while I think that we do need to figure out what will happen in 2018, we have a bigger issue that needs to be addressed as well, which is that there are efforts being made for further business revenue to be brought into the town. That's a longer term issue. But an override needs to pass. And in order to do that, we need to convince those no voters that this is in fact necessary on a grander scale. It's a sensitive issue, but we did lose the override. And that means that what our priorities are was not the priority for those people that voted. And they are not in agreement with these efforts that we want to make. And I don't know what the solution there is, but I feel that it's worth mentioning.
Just one quick comment on that. I think your point is very well taken. I don't know that the voters gave us all the information.
Mm-hmm.
I think they gave us a clear piece of information that an override that would be designed to last a substantial period of time was beyond something they'd be willing to do. I don't know that that means that forget about it, you just need to cut everywhere and that's the end of it.
Agreed.
So how that balance takes place is a discussion that the committees are definitely going to be very, very engaged in to figure out how to do it right. I brought up a point last night, I'll bring it up again tonight. I am a little concerned about the notion that maybe we have 14 months to think about it, that we can just wait till next April. I think that's a really dangerous way to think about it. I think that will, any understanding of what's going on, I think could fade very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
I think it would not be in the town's interest to do that. And if we found ourselves in the same position next year, I don't really want to think about it.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I think the fall is critical. And I think it's asking so much of you guys to when you make it a spring vote, because you're going to have two radically different budgets. It's putting two budgets together. That's,
yep,
that's a lot of work. I think fall is the right time period.
Jean.
Thank you. I want to thank all of you for your thoughtful consideration. I get a really strong sense that there's a lot of common feeling in the room, which is we have a really big problem to solve. Paul, you said something that really reflects my thinking over the last few weeks is, we said if this override didn't pass, we'd be in a really, really, really difficult position. And we're in a really, really difficult position. So I think that's a really good articulation of the situation. I want to talk about both of the free cash requests separately. And I'm going to start with something positive because we could all use it. I am very appreciative of the support that the FinCom provided last year for the science curriculum year one. I know that we ended up not needing to use free cash for it, but my memory is you either voted to support it or there was a general consensus to support it for the reasons that you were saying. It is a one-time expense spread out over 3 years, certainly, but it is an appropriate use of free cash. And I don't know how engaged any of you are with our work. But in November, we got a report from some of the teachers who are using that curriculum,
mm-hmm.
and you would have been so happy that you supported it. The teachers overwhelmingly love this curriculum. the children are engaged in a way that is hard to articulate. I happen to have children in third and fifth grade, so my wheelhouse is right where this is happening, and I'm hearing it from parents on the blacktop. We love the new science curriculum. My kid came home with this. It's hands-on. It is teaching skills that go so much beyond a science education into the kind of skills you want any child to have, creative thinking, critical thinking, and ability to collaborate. There's a lot of reading and writing in this curriculum. It's the top-notch curriculum you could have for third through fifth graders. So it was money very, very, very well spent. So I want to thank you for that commitment last year. And the discussion tonight, where there seems to be support for year two, as many challenges as we have that we have to find a solution for, clearly, that's at least something we're doing right. And so we should be grateful for that. As to the second cut, the second request, which is the much larger request for the middle school positions, this is more for people who might be watching this on television. I don't think I'm telling anyone in this room something you don't know. It was the school committee's position that, based on two things, I think. One was community feedback, which I'm sure you know was quite strong on the middle school cuts. We heard a lot of concern about all of the cuts, but this one rose 10 decibel levels higher than anything else. We received a petition signed by hundreds of high school students. These kids are in high school, they're teenagers. This is not going to impact them, they're past middle school. Hundreds of signatures from high school students saying, don't do this. I took 7th and 8th grade foreign language and now I'm in high school and here's what it means to me. So it was staff, it was students, and it was parents and community members who were deeply concerned about it. So that was one thing that I think weighed on us that, whoa, in terms of community priority, this is one. The other thing I want to point out, it did come up, but I want to kind of put it in context, is last year we cut 2 elementary school positions and we haven't put them back. Elementary class sizes are at the absolute ceiling, pretty much across the district, for school committee guidelines. It appears next year that we will be able to live within those guidelines
right now.
Because of some good luck with low enrollment. So we have seen in the last 2 years significantly increased elementary classroom sizes. We're right at the top of what is acceptable. A couple of families move into a district, we're going to be over those guidelines, and there is at this point nothing we can do about it. So that is a cut we have made. That is an increase in class sizes we've seen, and we're on the trajectory for that to continue. At the high school, we have 3-point-something FTE cuts this year, and I believe it was 3-point-something last year.
Yes, that's correct.
So somewhere over 7 FTEs in the high school in the last 2 years. And if you just think about the high school, 7+ FTEs gone. And so class sizes the high school have raised. It's going to impact kids' abilities to get the sections and the courses that they want. This eventually is going to impact college acceptances. It will absolutely impact property values. The situation is very, very severe. And I bring that up as context to point out, I think, Vanessa, you made a really good point. The voters spoke. We didn't ask for free cash for those elementary positions. We didn't ask for free cash for the high school positions. The school system is absolutely suffering, and we accept it. The two driving forces, I think, behind the request for free cash and the urgency around the middle school positions, one was sort of this lack of certainty about an override. Is there going to be one? Is there going to be one next month? Is there going to be one in the fall? Is there going to be one? There was this very great uncertainty about, is that going to happen? And the reason that's important is because when we solve the revenue problem, we hire 2 elementary positions, class sizes normalize. We hire 7 high school positions, class sizes normalize, AP offerings go back to where they should be. Those are easy fixes. The middle school cuts aren't like that at all. We were looking at a systemic change to how foreign language is taught in our district. So this year, 7th graders, all of whom are taking Spanish and French right now,
mm-hmm.
would head into 8th grade and we'd say 2/3 of you are going to be able to access that. 1/3 won't. We would be telling this year's 6th graders who are fully anticipating taking French and Spanish next year, no, our town can no longer afford to offer that. That's not how we teach foreign language. You don't. You have to wait till 8th grade and then you have a 2 out of 3 chance of getting it. This year's 7th graders, the 1/3 that didn't get it, would literally have to take 8th grade off from foreign language study and then start again in 9th grade. It defied any kind of organizational or systemic logic. These cuts were so destabilizing was the word that our colleague on the committee, Nick, used, and I agree with it completely. that combined with the community concern about it, but our own sense of this destabilizes the school system in a way that the other cuts don't. They're awful, they're bad, they have a negative impact on student achievement, but they're easily reversible. New income, new revenue comes in, we can reverse those. These middle school cuts, how do you reverse them if new revenue comes in? So I just wanted to share a little bit of why the committee chose these two priorities as being the ones that we, I think I speak for the committee when I say we would do anything. We will go to any lengths to try to protect these cuts if it's at all possible. So, thank you.
Understood. Other comment?
Just a little more context on those middle school cuts. I mean, the next question might be, well, why then choose those to cut? And the all or nothing nature of those cuts reflects the fact that we're working really hard to keep the middle school model. We know the anxiety level of kids are rising. We know that there's a lot of demands on kids. The middle school model enables teachers to work together with their priority being the children, as opposed to the old junior high school model, which has it's organized around the disciplines. In the middle school model, it's organized around children. So teachers on one team see all of those children regularly. And so the discussions that they have are about those children and the welfare of those children, the whole children, not just in English or in history. And the way I thought our administrators were very creative in figuring out a way to preserve that model. But the fallout is this foreign language. And when we gave pushback about not wanting to lose all of foreign language in middle school, they worked again for another one of the iterations of the budgets to figure out how we could save at least those two-thirds
for the elective
in eighth grade. So there was a whole process getting to there with the priority set about keeping that middle school model and choosing the least worst of the worst options. So I just wanted to throw that into the mix.
Yeah, no, it's appreciated.
Understanding.
I think that I suspect from the committee, we who are dealing with the numbers and hearing and watching what's going on in the process, understand, sympathize, and want it to work. And so we need a long-term solution to do that. That's where we are. And that's what we need to all figure out kind of how to do.
I have a question on the short term portion of it. So I've read through this letter. Perhaps I missed it. And was there a larger presentation yesterday?
Let me ask you, make a suggestion. A couple things. I think we want to talk about this. I think that this, and we'll let Bob talk about it. Obviously, it's his document. I think that there'll be a lot of discussion that will come in February and March, obviously, related to that and related to how it impacts budget and support and activities. And you know, we can talk some tonight. I'm sure Bob has some stuff he can talk about, but I think it's kind of a longer meaning weeks, not longer meaning anything other than that.
Okay.
What I was going to suggest is that there are a couple things. Bob did an update on accommodated costs, which I think is another part of kind of where there are, you know, pieces of this jigsaw puzzle that come together. It might be worth having that information, asking Bob to present that. We can kind of hear where that is. That obviously has implications on all these things. And the last thing I'd say before turning it is that we did talk about $1.2 million as the amount that FinCom would support toward taking to town meeting. As of right now, I'll let Bob talk about the accommodated costs. It may just be $1.1 that's required, including some of the changes, which would leave $100,000 nominally toward the $1.2. Bob, let me turn it to you for the accommodated costs.
Thanks, Mark. On to page 5 of Mike's handout. I'll just step you through a few things. John and Gail and I have met with Maya, our health insurer, at 4 o'clock this afternoon with the 3 union folks. So this document in front of you does not reflect the happy news we heard at 4 o'clock. Well, I'll get to that, just so everyone can be a little less sad.
top of page five, though, I think the most important thing is that 1.25% operating budget forecast from the financial forum in the fall did not change. Sometimes it goes up half to 1% as we sort of find, you know, breaks in accommodated costs along the way. What this tells you to start with is, you know, after the override failed, we took a hard look at everything, and we put the best optimistic face we could on all the revenues, and were careful but realistic with the accommodated costs. And that's going to be a lesson that's also similar to the regeneration lesson is, you know, the happy surprises are not going to be like they were for the last few years because we really are kind of blowing the barrel. So what this suggests is we needed another $260,000 of free cash. We could see the $1,360,000. That's because of the shortfall in state aid from the governor's budget, plus the increase in state assessments. We had forecast each of those as up 2.5%. State aid came in at plus 0.9%, and state assessments came in as plus 9.1%. So I was in at Beacon Hill last week, and I suggested they might have reversed those by mistake. And
what'd they say?
They did not seem to think that was going to happen.
What was the dollar? Sorry.
Like $267,000.
That's right. Most for state aid.
And that's, net of assessments. To step through kind of the column out there in the right-hand margin, that changed two different ways. It was decreased by $100,000, and I'll get to the reason that John and I had found some money, if you will. I know it's a bad expression, but in January, and agreed just to reduce the use of free cash. But then we had to increase it because of this loss of state aid that was forecast up to $260,000. I think based on the health insurance news we got today, we'll probably be able to knock that $260,000 back off and be back to $1,000,001, just to clarify that. There's a couple of moving parts I'll just note at the bottom of page one. Some of the accommodated cost savings were moved into the school's operating budget and special ed in particular, so that explains why they do not have a 1.25% increase. On page six, there's the actual decrease in state aid versus our forecast, $217,000. On page seven, it's a bit of a mystery to me how this happened or why this happened, but our pension assessment for the current year was $100,000 too high. The Reading Retirement Board had stated and still states they increase it by 4.5% every year. They didn't this year, and I don't really know why. It had to do with actuarial work and whether people were in the general fund, water, sewer. I don't fully understand it. But nonetheless, our forecast of another up 4.5% for FY18 was reduced by $100,000. We actually reduced the FY17 number. You'll see a budget amendment in April to that effect. So $100,000 of pension assessments was less than we had forecast because of something that happened this year, not next year, as a baseline.
But how, oh right, because we're in 17. That's
yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I get very mixed up. My memory mistake, by the way. I'll get to that some other time. So that $100,000 went into capital. I'll come back to that. We saved $50,000 in fuel on page eight. That went into capital. And specifically, the $150,000 of capital that was added, if you will, at the last minute, was funding for the permanent building. So they had been requesting funds pretty much since inception. And this will give them $150,000 of a baseline amount for next year for whatever projects they may engage in. May they all bring in new revenues.
Soon.
And as you recall, and I know you know, that the capital plan really did get damaged by the TLT settlement. A lot of things had to get moved out. So short of finding the $150,000 this way, there was no easy way to get that funding.
Mm-hmm. And then was there another $100,000 here that moved capital?
The $100,000 from pension and the $50,000 from fuel were both moved into capital. That's all.
Oh, that nets out to $150,000.
Nets out to
$150,000.
Oh,
okay.
Yep.
I thought it was an additional.
You can see again in the middle of page eight, the school department actually was able to knock off $300,000 from out of district special ed. $200,000 went back into their budget in district for special ed, and $100,000 is the reduction in the use of free cash. That's how that piece ties
mm-hmm.
together. And then the last item is the other part of net state aid, state assessments going up, $43,000. So there's kind of a couple of relatively small moving parts, maybe a bigger one.
but really considering this time of year, there's not much of a change financially from what was forecast in last October, November.
And, excuse me, before you said, so the two big risks that we have noted in the budget, that we always are kind of guessing where they're going to come in and estimating, on balance, came out okay this year. So that being the healthcare estimated.
Right, so what was the healthcare then? I didn't feel like.
It's about 260,000 less than we forecast stated. It was about 260,000 more. So, you know, they kind of took care of each other, that Mark's point. And those are really both really important numbers, because it's not just a one-time cost. Those are both baselines for the future.
Right.
So it's
so
nice
that
they each offset each other. It's collective bargaining.
Do you mean instead of being at 8.5%,
yeah,
it's a lower number?
We had assumed 7.5 in the budget, just to be clear, and it's below.
Oh, 7.5.
I don't want to say yet because the unions have not.
I thought we were 8.5 too.
I just got it this afternoon. So.
But Bob, you said with the news you got this afternoon that, sorry, going back to page 5 or the first page of this, the circle 1.3 and 1.36 million. That's looking more like 1.1.
Correct.
Okay. Make sure you have the right number.
Yep.
Okay.
And we had
which back
authorized
to our
1.2.
We had authorized 1.2, so put this in the window. Okay. Good.
So the good news is that the, you know, the hedge the FinCom had allowed, if you will, against those two happened to net out this year.
Again.
That's not always true.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you can be good and lucky. Remember which one is better, right?
But, you know, frankly, all that did was allow the next couple of years to be less than 1.5% instead of 1%. That's certainly 1.5 is a lot better than 1, but
it's still
no rose is growing.
Trivial. Yeah. I'm sorry, Ellie.
I just had a question, and maybe this is something that you agreed on, but the 300,000 reduction in the out of district, but then, which is because we do really good work. Carolyn is amazing. It's been a priority of ours, and we really are getting some traction on that with our new director of student services. But then only 2/3 of that went back into our operating end. Maybe there's a rationale for that, but I feel like you know, some other priorities.
There is a rationale. I should probably tell you before
okay.
you go to the next page. I looked at the last 5 years of your different cost centers. Computed that in-district special ed was growing at a faster rate than your other cost centers, regular ed in particular. That would have worked out to, I can't remember, 125 or 150,000. So we just rounded it to 200,000 and said that's good enough. That'll take you a step future in the future
mm-hmm.
if you have to incur more costs in district in order to bring students from out of district. It gives you that flexibility.
Okay. All right. So it was based on some historical
data.
I guess I think also that when you talk about things that need to be looked at going forward, I think there's been some discussion about, you know, looking at the accommodated model. I think that needs to be a priority for us, and to be looking at the how the total budget percentage-wise is allocated and make sure that we feel like this is appropriate. Right? Used to be a lot closer to 70-30, and it's not that now, and I think that needs to be a dialogue as we sort of go through this year and are taking a hard look at it.
Remember, there is the facility shift, number one, so that's
right.
going to change the ratio, but it's probably, I think it's a really good idea to just understand what's going on in any event, but I think that's probably one of the reasons why it shifted several percent. Sorry, Bob.
No, I was going to say the same thing. I'm certainly fine to look at it. It was never 73rd.
Okay.
Never. Doesn't mean it won't get there.
Okay. Let's leave open the possibility, because educating children is not getting to be less of a task. We had a town member come to our meeting and highlight that our enrollment as a district is the same as it was in 1967. But what you did for students in 1967 and what you do for students in 2017 is completely different. So just, right, we have to be cautious.
I think
think I got gas for the lawnmower for about 35 cents a gallon then.
And not all children were taught.
Trust me, I wasn't driving, but anyway. So let's come back to Vanessa's question. And I don't want to put you on the spot, Bob. Do you want to talk a little bit about this, the proposal at this point, or would you rather accept questions?
Do you think you want to take a crack at summarizing it? It's really your budget. I'll do it if you want, but I'd leave you that choice.
You mean this?
Yeah, just what we discussed.
Sure. So my understanding is from what was discussed last night, and then Bob and I and Gail met this afternoon also to further the conversation. The seven FTE teachers in this proposal are back into the budget. So the seven middle school teachers are back in the budget. The budget that would be moved forward by the town manager would be the budget that was under the original FinCom guidance from November.
Right.
As part of that, and really looking at it as both a town and school total budget, and instead of two separate budgets. And then the understanding is that through, you know, various means, and both on the town and the school side, that we would be working diligently to see if there are other ways, through expenses and other means, holding off one-time purchases, things like that, to find a way to whittle down the 438 as much as possible to a point where either we're able to accomplish that or we need to go at some point to town meeting, either November or April, next April, not this April, next April, for the remaining amount. One of the cautions that I stated to Bob today is there are always, and I'm sure the town has the same thing, there were a lot of surprises that happened during the school year. You know, some happened this year when we had an administrator that was on medical leave cross two fiscal years for almost a year. And you need to fill that position, so you're essentially carrying two salaries. You may have a student move in from another community that has out-of-district special education costs that we have to pay out of the school department budget. So those are things that we do not normally budget for. So sometimes we do get some savings in hiring over the summer, but that is becoming less and less, we find over the years. When a teacher leaves, a lot of times we're bringing a teacher in at about the same, sometimes more. So I caution about in November being the date that we would have a good handle, because I'm not sure that we would on expenses. So that was just one caution I brought up today.
I know, and with teachers, it's not like unfilled. Sorry.
Yeah, and you can't, right, you're right. You can't leave it unfilled. Yeah.
When it's a teacher.
You need a grade two classroom teacher.
Right.
You can't
yep.
leave
but
the classroom.
If there's
open.
Some good windfall, maybe other years, that's when we would have gotten that regeneration in the spring
right.
to say, oh,
yep.
look, we can turn back $300,000
right.
to free cash.
Yeah.
Right.
That's not going to happen because you'll be desperately trying to reallocate it elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. Can you hold for one sec, Eric? Go to Jean.
And this is just a really, thank you, because it's a really quick addition to what Dr. Doherty was saying. It's actually a question that came up before we voted the budget. This exact question came up. And the only thing I wanted to add to what you said with all those cautions, the number's also very volatile.
Yes.
Some
yes.
years there does appear to be a cushion, and some years there really isn't, and there's no good way to predict it. It really does depend on staff. So in addition to the unexpected needs, the number itself is pretty volatile. So I just wanted to throw that out there.
And just to piggyback on your point, retirements have played a big role in that. And
yeah.
there have been years where we've had a lot of retirements.
Yeah.
This year, I think we have two. So when you have less retirements, your delta of savings is going to go down. So, you know, it's just something to keep in mind.
Before you do that, I'm negligent of the point that someone was trying to get to me. For RCTV, we heard that the video was going in and out, so I don't know if someone from RCTV can hear me, but if you can, if there's a way you can look into that would be great. Sorry, go ahead.
Okay.
Jean, you want to piggyback again?
No one. Too old for piggyback.
I have one piggyback.
If not, the answer is Beaver Road, but go ahead.
So just so I'm crystal clear, Dr. Doria, so you said, you said the budget that's going to move forward, meaning come to FinCom, you said was the budget, the number that we that was talked about in November?
The presentation you will hear from myself and the school committee will be, includes the seven teachers. But the number, the bottom number,
combined,
it will be the number of the FinCom recommended
and
number.
And that number you're talking about is town and school combined.
I think that's probably the best way to, because both the town and schools are going to be looking at ways to whittle down that 438.
Right.
And that's supported by the 1.2 million in free cash, or 1.1 at this point?
Probably 1.1.
Okay.
No, it's the same budget. It hasn't been, yeah.
Right. We made different choices on what we're cutting.
No.
No.
We're just taking a high risk.
Yes.
Which is.
Well put.
That's.
Right, we didn't, exactly, we're still cutting the 813,010.9 FTE, only we asked for additional free cash to support. I'm just going to talk the 438,000, the seven teachers for the foreign language and the English language, sixth grade English language. And the collective proposal that town manager presented last night, and I should have taped it, Bob, so that I could also listen to your comments, and Dr. Daugherty and Gail reviewed today, is basically saying we're not going to actually cut those positions, but somewhere across the full scope of the budget of the town, we're going to spend the year, the next 6 to whatever months, right, looking for those opportunities where we can gain some advantage. And if we don't find that, then we need to come back. Bob Sure suggested it was November town meeting to say, we found X amount, we still have this gap, and now we need to see if it comes in town meeting. Is that right?
But I think we're saying the same thing. If you keep those in, it's the same total pie.
Yeah.
So we need to, whether you want to say find or cut, I mean,
create.
Yeah, it's right. Yeah, I mean, it's coming to the same thing. We're talking about a same total dollar amount. So if something stays in, something's coming
out. Something went up, something went down.
If I might, just per the charter, you will see the voted school committee budget, which is the higher figure. You must. That's in the charter. And that will be higher.
The town manager's version, if you will, of the school budget will be 588,000 lower in order to balance the FinCom's guidance.
Whoa, back up. What's that again? What did you just say?
The school committee budget as voted, which includes.
Oh, yes. Okay.
500.
That's right.
Is it 588?
Yes.
Yes.
588.
Okay, 588 higher,
yes,
than is balanced.
Mm-hmm.
You must see that by the charter.
Okay.
It's semantics, but
yes.
I just want to
no,
make sure
totally
when you see it, you understand.
Is that what the voter
they will then describe the budget, and the only thing different, if you will, is that the funding mechanisms are both different from that 588. One is, you know, April town meeting, and one is next year sometime. But you will see
mm-hmm.
that as an essence. And what I'm saying is the bottom line can be adjusted down 588 because of those paths.
So the budget that we will see,
so you will
presented
see
to us,
you will see a budget that looks just like the school committee budget, but it will have a bottom line total from the town manager that's 588,000 less.
So if you will, the town side is going to be less 588.
No.
Okay, then I'm not following.
Yeah, right. It will be the lower number on the school budget.
Okay, so that's the
it'll be,
as presented.
I don't remember the numbers,
right.
Whatever. The components of it will include all the things they wanted.
Right.
Well, the science piece will be.
And then the
science piece
will
be
pulled out for April funding.
Right.
Right.
but it's in the voted budget, so you need to see it that way. I think that's the same way it happened last year.
Yeah, yeah.
I think in my memo I said it was 2 years.
Yes.
It just feels like it was 2 years ago last year.
It was, yeah, it was 16.
We said the same.
It was 16, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So let's just chase this down for a second.
And then the town budget will be balanced to FinCom's guidance from the fall also.
To the town's number?
Correct. And then during the year.
Right.
If the school budget does not balance to that number, then at a town meeting, the town is willing to transfer money over, and we may need to ask for some help from town meeting to balance the school budget.
So
I'm still not there.
So my understanding is that there's, we're over by the approximately half a million.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We're hoping to find ways over the course of fiscal year 18 to creatively redistribute that half a million in order to save those seven positions. However, if we are unable to creatively redistribute half a million dollars in order to keep these teachers, the request will be made to pull that half a million to patch the gap again from free cash.
But the money, because the money's already spent.
Because the money has already been allocated,
fair.
Right?
Right,
yeah.
Like,
not
that's
just, to be clear, the role of the town accountant is quite important here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't put up with nonsense.
So,
let me explain it.
Yeah, let's.
On or before June 30th, the town accountant must have from the schools, and the school committee must vote after town meeting, a balanced budget. So she will need to see line items that add up to that lower dollar figure. The $150,000 is easy.
Yeah.
That'll have already been funded by capital. She will work with John and Gail to figure out how to present a balanced budget for you guys to use during the year.
That would be fun.
And then as things go, as they go on into the year, they're gonna realize, oh yeah, we're able to balance, or oh boy, we're not at all. And then at a future town meeting, it doesn't matter to me whether it's November or April, we'll probably have others also. Then the budget will need to be repaired if need be. But it does by law have to be balanced.
Yeah, can you start at the top first? I follow the negotiation toward the end. I want to start at the very beginning. Round numbers for a second. Is it 35-23? What are the non-accommodated costs, school and town budget numbers?
Don't.
What I'm trying to do is come up with, into FinCom will come a number for a budget that will equal the FinCom suggested total.
I think it's on the bottom of page 5, maybe.
My understanding is going to be the same numbers.
You should see these numbers at the bottom that say municipal government total and school total. Those
so
are
the 26 and 41.
Yes.
Okay. In that 41, does that include the additional 588?
It includes seven teachers. Forget what it costs.
The numbers
don't
are
going
okay.
Yourself
okay.
He's going to have
okay.
Seven more teachers.
Can I say it another
okay.
way? The numbers are going to be wrong. That the right they will be.
They need to sit
the components.
With the
yes.
Got it. Okay.
And then you'll have to try to find ways.
Got it.
To
so
achieve that.
Got it. So to FinCom and then. Depending on what happens through FinCom, going to town meeting, we will see numbers that will be, as laid out here, a total of about $67 million between municipal and school,
correct.
Just based on these here. That's a total that we'll be reviewing, and it's a total that, you know, from there to town meeting. That's where it starts. The components, is what I'm hearing, may shift around.
Yeah, and just to gently remind FinCom and then town meeting, the components are not any of our purview. It's only their purview.
On the school side.
The school committee has bottom line.
Right. Okay. So by having the higher number there, that's what assures that, essentially. By having the 588 in there, that assures that.
No, it's
not in there.
It's not in there.
The 7
FTE are going to be in there.
The positions are, but the money is not.
So I have a hypothetical. Okay, so.
Not quite there yet. Okay.
Oh, I've got it. Okay. So the seven positions are in, regardless of what the cost is, that's fine. This half a million that we're dealing with. Hypothetically,
the
goal is to find ways to cut over the course of the entire municipal government expenses, that half a million, is that correct?
438. I think you gotta switch the 120.
I agree.
Yeah, 438.
Take the 150 out.
Okay, 438.
So that 433, that
38.
438, the 438. So we have this 438, we're keeping these teachers. Hypothetically, that 438 will be cut from some other portion of the entire government expenses in some fashion or another, but we don't know what it is.
Maybe.
Right?
That's true, it's maybe.
So it's
maybe, that's important.
Worst case, hopefully worst case.
So hypothetically, what happens if that 438 isn't cut? Because essentially what we're doing is we're...
Town meeting has to vote on it.
But now, but the money has already been spent. So we're putting town meeting in a situation where they cannot vote no. That's not an option.
Sure they can.
And then what happens?
And then we default?
Then we have to really balance our budgets, just like when the governor cuts state aid in the middle of the year.
Bob, who does, does any other town do this? Like, is this common practice?
This seems like an extreme practice.
But I understand, we go into the budget conservatively, and that's why we feel comfortable using free cash million, because we regenerate, because every year, lately every year, our revenues have come in better than expected, our expenses have come in less than expected. So now we're hedging our bet up front. We're saying, okay, we'll take that risk up front.
But if not, they would put it back. If they didn't spend it, they would give it back to us.
Right, and that's why we've regenerated more than a million for the last few years.
Right.
We're hedging our bet up front. And so that's why the regeneration we're going to see next year is not going to be what we've seen other years.
We spent it again.
But is it exposure that we might be left?
We're exposing seven additional heads in there too, so we're not just...
Yes. Right, so we're not doing this casually,
no.
But it's overstaffed positions that we feel strongly about. But that's exactly, we're taking on risk.
We're being asked for $438,000 in free cash.
Yes.
That may become smaller if we can find some savings during the year.
But that is not a guarantee.
Yeah, agreed. That's why I'm flipping it the other way and saying the request is $438,000 in free cash that you may try to lower as the year goes on.
Bob.
You have to understand that if I didn't do what I did last night, you have seven teachers that have no guarantee they have a job until sometime in mid-May. That is a big difference.
That's the biggest reason. Otherwise, I can't see the financial perspective.
No.
I cannot see any reason to do it this way versus any other way except for those teachers, and that makes a lot of sense.
So the other part of that will be that during the budget meetings that will be taking place March 1, 8:15. We'll have a chance to look at some areas, and I assume we'll talk in a little bit more detail about potential. I'm going to stop using the finding kind of stuff. Potential opportunities of, right, things that we won't do that could go toward that number. In addition, conceivably, at least as of right now, based on 1.2 million that we would suggest to town meeting, only 1.1 of it is taken so far. So there's a little bit of it there.
As FinCom, giving another 400. Isn't that really what we're doing?
Yeah.
And we've said, and I get it, but Bob, you had said to me, because I was in favor of giving a large amount of right, you said, it's reckless, don't do it.
Mm-hmm.
And now you're saying to us, do it.
Read my memo carefully.
No,
yeah.
I'm just a little concerned about this money.
Yeah.
Right.
But it doesn't mean I'm right.
No, I hear you.
The 438, right? The 438 too, because I'm looking at it that way and saying, essentially, we're being asked for $438,000 in free cash. Based on what we found out this afternoon, that we're using $1.1 million of our $1.2 million, right? I think based on the guidance we gave, there's $100,000 there. So we have $338,000 that we are looking at. There are several other assumptions that can change during the year, but we knew that when we got comfortable with $1.2 million. So if we want to hold consistent to what we were saying, let's go to the $1.2 million. Let's now say we have $338,000 of exposure. To Bob's point, the memo is written that while not walking through exactly where it's going to come from, there is, and please correct me if I'm wrong, there's a high degree of certainty that some of that will be saved.
I can can guarantee you some of it will be saved.
I am comfortable
I
then.
I have to pull out my own wallet.
The number, again, give me the rough rounding. We're down to a...
I can't.
No, I'm not asking
right,
you
not
to.
Asking.
I'm just saying, right. We're talking about 300,000-ish or less, which is not an insignificant amount of money, but we need to have... We need to know some level of money that we can have a conversation about, because we talk about $1.2 million. We talk about all these different numbers. Let's truly focus on what is the incremental ask. And, okay, now...
Would it be fair to say that it's essentially that 338 would be coming out of free cash one way or the other? Essentially,
we may save some of it and not have
because,
to.
Because
it would be added to the free cash. Because
it's what we're not, what we won't end up regenerating in free cash for the next year. So in a sense, it's coming from like the next years regeneration.
The only difference
right.
is, I would imagine
it just
as you go
when.
It's timing.
And some of it's, as you go through your budget cycles and you learn and you save
okay.
some money, let's say you say, oh gosh, I'm in a position where I get to save 20. So mentally, as you go through a year, you're probably thinking, good, I really had that $20,000 need. This year, it will be like, I can't go to that $20,000.
It's spoken for.
So there's a lot less flexibility in balancing the different.
Yeah, I agree with the comment John made. Example that we've come to. Over a 10-year period, as budget gets tighter, your level of tolerance for pain changes, because otherwise you'd go crazy. The things we do now, I could never have imagined 10 years ago. We had to cut out the spare crossing guard from the police budget last year. That was unthinkable 5 years ago. What if we need one during the year? We can't have kids running across the street. That's not safe. We cut it out. That cushion is gone.
That's what parents
not
for.
not a huge amount of money, but you know, what police officers can go do the job if they have to, and that means they're not doing something else. But that's the absurd level we've got to. And you know, I've been rightly criticized, and I agree that we've kind of hidden the cost of running the organization.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to run the organization. So perhaps in a marketing sense, we should have been blowing the horn louder and saying, you know, this is terrible. This is awful. But the fact remains that Dr. Dorian and I have to run departments with whatever money is available and do the best job we can. And I'm sure we're both living with realities that we had never envisioned before and making cuts that we could have never even imagined would you'd ever get to. And the scary part is there's probably more of that ahead without more money.
Yep.
And things that we now think, oh, that's off the table. It won't be.
Jean, you had a comment?
Very quick point, and you actually just started to make it, Bob. The only way any of this makes sense is if there's an override vote in the near future. I know we said it at the beginning, but this discussion about it is a complete patch, and we're gonna look for efficiencies here and there across the, and there'll be less regeneration, and we'll be more aggressive in our assumptions, and we may have to ultimately come back and ask for free cash. None of that makes sense if it isn't a stopgap to ask the voters again, a different ask. But it truly is. And I want to make that clear, when we were discussing the budget, it was 100% clear that we were only making the ask if there was the expectation of an override in the interim, because that is the only permanent solution.
John, how to comment?
I'm going to try to answer Paul's question. I don't know if it was a question or a statement, but historically in the school department budget, if there is savings at the end of a fiscal year, it comes from one of two places, either savings from hiring or savings in special education. Very rarely do we see savings in anything else.
Okay.
So, but that's volatile, as I think Gene used the word volatile earlier. So that's what I think we're talking about here, is that maybe we will be able to recoup some savings from the one of those two areas.
Okay.
I said this last night, I should tell you that, the only reason that I felt I had to step in there were hundreds of emails that came in, and this is not encouraging everyone else to send an email about what they want. Hundreds of emails came in from parents who did not vote last fall. It's not that they didn't understand, they did not vote. So it's fair to assume that these people did not understand how important their vote was. And if I thought there wasn't going to be another override vote for another 3 years, I wouldn't have wasted my time. But this is just a 1-year bridge on what seemed to be a very important, sensitive issue. And Don and I talked about it, and it was all or none. There was, you can't, you know, you can't cut the proverbial baby in half here. It's all or none. Yeah, that's what we used to say. And it was an extreme measure, there's no question. It's, you're exactly right, Mark. It's taking a much higher risk profile here. It may work, it may not, but it's not going to be worse than asking for the cash up front.
Bro, that's fully 100% for it. I think it's, yeah. I think it's a great solution. I think that there needs to be a lot of communication around this, because my first reaction to it was what I think a lot of people's first reaction to it is, it's a shell game, right? You're just moving it around. Where's the money? Can you find it? Or you can't find it. And to your point, Bob, and you said, you know, you've been criticized for hiding the cost of running government. This feels like the same tactic. So I 100% agree with it, because those teachers don't know they have jobs, and that is far more important than that. But I just feel like this needs to be laid out super clearly for folks, so that there's not the backlash that we all know can happen if people feel like the wool's being pulled.
Right. So this would become the, now that we've tamed the health beast and the state aid beast this year.
This year.
We're now talking about bringing in a new beast.
We were told medical inflation was running at 11%. We just happened to get a lower renewal.
Yeah. Fortunately, for the last couple of years, I think that's kind of how it played out. Elaine was next. Sorry.
So I just want to, Dr. Hardy highlighted the two areas where we typically might see some benefit, and then in past years, that transfers back to free cash and to regeneration, the hiring and spend. But I just want to, we have looked in every corner of our budget. I don't expect that between now and the time we present our budget to you in March, that we're not going to find something else. We have looked at everything. We have been.
I don't think the expectation.
No.
Okay,
yeah.
So
yeah.
We have been very transparent.
Yeah.
If you have, after you read the budget and after you read the answers to the 93 questions, if you guys have other questions, then I'm quite sure we will ask Dr. Daugherty and Gail and his staff to answer your questions for us. So, and it will become part of the budget presentation. So I just wanted to really, I want to make sure that that's understood. So I have one other thing that hasn't been talked about, but when we talk about maybe some of the differences, and I haven't been on the Board of Selectmen, so I don't know intimately the municipal sides and how those run. But when we need to get a teacher, right, because we need a teacher in a classroom, we have to do that. You have to remember, we're not happy about this. We are a level 3 district. We have had to do some things to support our elementary school and provide additional resources, and we have to do that. The state is working with us to help and support and advise, but in the end, we have to put the resources there. So when you think about the situation that we're in and how important it is that over the next 7 or 8 months before we have an override, how important it is that this community, that we are able to bring the community together, and whether that takes community discussions or videos of every leader and all kinds of parents saying that this is important and this is why, or a World Cafe discussion, we're going to have to do that. But I just...
It's and, not or.
Right, we have to do all
those
of
pieces.
Those things. But I just don't want people to think that between now and when we come see you, we're going to have some other...
Yeah, so just from a process point of view, what would be great, and I know this is starting to happen anyway, so... Bob's going to be sending us a budget in the next week to two.
Near to the end of February.
Right, so okay, by the end of the month.
Yeah.
If the budget from the school department is going to, from the school committee, is what it is, the sooner that we can get that will allow us to review it and get you any questions that we may have. So I'd encourage that process to take place. I don't know why we need to wait, right? We'll get back to you sooner is what that'll come back to. So if you can do that, that would be wonderful. I lost my other point. Go ahead, Linda. Sorry.
Sorry. I just wanted to thank Paul and Mark for the way that you reframed that question in terms of the risk, in terms of the we're putting the request, if we need it later, into the fall, in order to keep the teachers and keep the program intact. And again, Bob, thank you for being this creative thinking. What I wanted us to be prepared for in the fall at town meeting was the reaction that people had to the lawsuit, where they felt they should have known about it before, and they should have had a say in the costs that were amounting. And so I think that the way Mark and Paul explained it is really helpful, and that will be really key at town meeting in response to their concerns that they didn't have a say, that we knew we were gonna accrue these costs, and so we backed them into a corner that they had to pay them because we've already spent them. So I just wanted to say that out loud, because I think we're gonna need to anticipate those concerns from town meeting. And they're not illegitimate. But
I remember my other point.
It was important.
So last night we did have a discussion, though, about, as we're thinking about 338 to 438, that number, there was a discussion about possible things that would not be spent, that I just want to encourage in the next five weeks. The ones that we can identify, that would be great. That helps us kind of manage what this number is and whittle it down. I remember some numbers getting thrown out, you know, kind of 100 here, 100 there, and conceivably 100 from free cash. That would get us a good ways to the goal line. So I hear you loud and clear that everything's been scraped. I don't think it's scraping this time. I think it may be, as Bob laid it out, stuff that we're just not going to spend right now. Not upgrading the, you know, Microsoft stuff for another period of time. And the 10s and 20s may get us to where we can get to. I want to make sure that the process is taking us, there's a new risk being discussed. We need to manage the risk. What can we do to it? There's some things we can't, there's some things we can.
Just curious, kind of for the rest of FinCom to you know, as we look at, and I'll throw the 338 number out again, right? Like, all of us had a similar feeling when we saw the 125 on the science curriculum, that's one-time spending. Whenever we talk about free cash, we collectively tend to talk one-time spending versus, you know, ongoing operating costs. Everyone clearly seems to be on the same page that this whole plan here only works with an override in the future. Does the 338, that same number, just to be consistent, does the 338, hate to blur lines, but start to look more like the 125, as opposed to using free cash to supplement the ongoing operational budget? Because we know if there is no override, we're not digging deep into free cash again next year to keep that going. It's one and done. Mm-hmm. It takes on some characteristics of a one-time cost, because we're saying, geez, we really don't want it to be a one-time cost. We want to fund it some other way in the future. But when we think about how we would use free cash, it's a one-time out of free cash, and then it either needs something else or it's not going to happen, and then it gets cut.
So whatever that 338 funds,
yep,
will not fund again.
Right, needs to be funded in a different way going forward, but that may help us gain some comfort in funding it once out of free cash, if we need to, whatever that number comes down to.
So I don't want to try to get blood out of a stone, but part of this proposal, as it was laid out, looked at changing some policies in terms of whether it's, I'll use updating software because I just, that's one that you know, we talked about. There are some things that probably can mitigate this. Perhaps totally. It would be amazing if it did. I am very concerned that it could. But it may be able to get it below 338. So, you know, if the question was, hey, what do you think about, let's just drill 338 as a one-time cost, I'm not comfortable with that yet.
Yep.
I applaud the creative efforts taken here. I'm very concerned about how this will be perceived and the precedent it could set as far as how we handle budgets in the future. Because what we are saying is, well, we want to keep these teachers in the budget, and I understand the importance of that and how difficult it would be and the damage it could do to the schools and the structure of the curriculum. But what if it wasn't this particular program, or some other expense? We don't want to cut it. So we're going to keep it in the budget, and if we can't find a way to pay for it, we'll just take it to town meeting and it has to come out of free cash. Or then, as Bob mentioned, then we really do have to balance the budget and severe consequences. So how is this going to be perceived? Because it doesn't feel like we're giving town meeting any real choice in the matter. Now, I understand that there is the possibility that some of it will come back because it's an educated, informed decision of where these alternate funds could come from, or other items that could be cut, turnover, et cetera. But it is a shell. That's exactly what we're doing. And I it makes me very nervous that we would consider approving something like this when we know that the budget is not balanced off of this 438.
We already found 100,000.
The longer you talk, the lower it doesn't get lower. Sorry, it doesn't work that way.
I would much rather have it be up front and say we need X in order to keep these seven positions and put that in front of town meeting with FinCom's approval. And then if it isn't necessary, if we are able to cut something else, or it does end up coming up at the end of the year that all of that funding wasn't needed, then it can regenerate. But this is a dangerous game that we're playing. And who's to say that a future school committee or a future FinCom, however many years down the line when none of us are no longer involved, won't say, well, they did this back then, and maybe we can do it, except maybe it's $2 million instead of just 300 or 40.
Can I just say that is what we were asking. I realize you might not have seen our budget yet before last night's meeting, so I just want to be clear that is what the school committee's voted budget is asking, as it stands, as it's voted. And, you know, Mr. Robinson on the committee is a 9-year veteran of FinCom. So when he put that proposal together, we were very cognizant of what we were asking. I think that the one piece that that this solution that the town manager and that John and Gail reviewed today is that it basically enables us to move forward and not have to have teachers in a ambiguous position between now and April, subject to that vote.
Understood. My comment and response was, you know, if you said to me, let's do it, I would say I'm not comfortable with that right now at all.
Right. And
there are three ways that this can get mitigated. Okay. One is to explore some opportunities and see what's there by changing policies and not spending and other things like that. That's one. There's no money that's coming out of the sky here. So that's one. Number two is actually to spend some free cash. And number three would be to have an override that impacts fiscal 18.
Okay, that's not gonna.
Well, nothing is nothing, right? So the notion of putting the override out definitely to fiscal 19, it was already problematic to me. If it happens in November, can that impact fiscal 18? The answer probably would be yes, right? No, it couldn't?
No.
Couldn't, it's done. That's fiscal 19, even if it passed in November.
Well, let's just say the schools have to start the school year with a balanced budget.
I'm saying that if, back to the discussion, I hate to talk it of kind of paying it forward a little bit. If we say it's a risk we won't understand until November.
I think by law, an override must start at a fiscal year and you can't go backwards.
Okay, then that's it, straightforward. Okay.
So now there are only two solutions left, right? So, you know, if the question is, hey, are you guys comfortable at 338? My personal response would be no. So we have to find a way to mitigate that number. I mean, to me, that's what it is. I'm just, if it comes out and says, hey, let's just use it in free cash, I think that's what we started. Bob?
At the beginning of the discussion was going around to FinCom, you all said the same thing he just said. No, we're not comfortable using much more free cash. Have you changed your mind?
If our only options are push it forward to November and hope that the budget gets balanced, or we have to go to town hall or town meeting, or pull it in advance from FinCom. I mean, if these are literally our only two options in order to reach this 388, in my mind, increasing the amount of free cash up front is the better option. It's much more transparent. It's more easily understood by the voters, in my opinion.
Yeah.
If there's a third option that I'm missing or I'm misinterpreting, then please correct.
James, next.
I wanted to answer, not really answer, but give my perspective on something Vanessa said, because it was a really good point, which is the precedent that this establishes. I'm glad you asked that question. My reaction to it is, so to your point, why is this acceptable and why does this not establish a precedent? Because it's a really good fear to have. I think the fact that this town hasn't approved an override in 14 years, and we just had a failed one, and can't emphasize this enough, without the commitment to one in the near future, none of this makes sense. So we're all assuming that there will be a commitment to an override that will answer the question finally, right? I think those are the mitigating factors, that if those exact things lined up, then I think Paul, you said it, this is a one-time Band-Aid expense to get until the voters can decide. And what we did hear from literally hundreds of parents is, please give me a chance to vote again. I didn't understand. I didn't vote. I didn't believe. You said, another thing that I think happened is we said 20 to 30 teacher cuts, and we all know what that means, right? Do you live in the town? I don't know how many teachers work in Reading. I don't know what that really means. Suddenly it's ELA in sixth grade, French and Spanish in seventh grade, and it becomes an elective in eighth grade, and it's like, oh, no, that's not okay. 20 to 30 teachers, I didn't know if that was okay or not, but this is definitely not okay. So I think a lot has changed. And there has been some discussion about a virtual shift in Reading to potentially more regular overrides. That would, if we went in that direction, be another mitigating circumstance where we wouldn't presumably have dug a 14-year-old hole that we were trying to dig ourselves out of. And if we had an override 3 years ago and we're in the same boat, I think it's easier for FinCom to say, the voters answered 3 years ago, ask them again. We do this every couple of years, as opposed to this situation, which I view as dire.
David.
And exceptional. I view this as an exceptional circumstance.
David, you were next.
You were on?
No, man.
Well, I was just going to say, fair enough, but I think the point you made, I think it makes absolutely sense, which is, if we're going to do anything, do it up front. I don't think any of us took a hold to roll the dice with the budget. That's what it seems like. And look at it. I mean, it took us, I don't know, more than half an hour to even get to this point to understand how is it going to work. And we're gonna ask the people who are not involved in this process to understand. I think we're just gonna make things worse. So if anything, if we believe that, hey, it's a one-time thing, we should vote up front.
Mark, you're next.
Yeah, I of all the meetings that I went to, in the financial forum in particular, I did not hear one person say, don't use free cash. Like, I heard people say, be careful, let's think through things. I never heard someone say, don't use free cash. Definitely don't do that. At least not a strong opinion. And I think people have engaged in these meetings and have talked about it. Bob said, you know, he's had too many phone calls to count of people saying, I just want another chance to vote. I wish I had the paper in front of me, but if we look at average regeneration, it was higher than that 1 million or 1.1 million that we chose, right? And that was, it was 3 million. And I know Paul and I went back and forth on this a little bit, trying to figure out what that number would be. And so I think that's why I'm comfortable saying, all right, we can do this with the hope maybe we spend less, but maybe not. Maybe we do hit some free cash for this, but it's a smaller amount. So you're kind of, this is truly a middle ground to me of doing it, kind of saying, here's the money, or no. I think this truly is that middle ground, and I really love that idea, because we're bridging that gap by saying, look, we're going to do our darndest as a town and as a school to see if we can make up any of this, even a dollar.
But you're saying upfront, offer $1.5 million free cash instead of saying, hey, let's...
No, I'm saying I think Bob's idea is the middle ground between the position to the two positions of people saying, I don't, you know, if the override's your barometer saying people don't want us to spend another dime, and you have these other folks that came to these meetings and spoke very loud and clear that we want you to do something to help the school budget because we can't cut foreign language and these teachers in the middle school, I feel like this is the middle ground, and I'm happy Bob found the solution. The more I hear about it, the more I kind of get excited about it, to be honest with you. I think it's a great compromise solution. I think it needs to be explained to the public very clearly, and like I said, I've said that already. I think this has to be laid out on a slide and let people ask the same questions we've asked so that it's fully understood how and why we're doing it. But I think it's a great solution.
Just wanted to respond to Bob to your question, right? We all started, or at least I'll speak for me. I started and said I was comfortable with the 1.2, the number we said, and you just asked, okay, now are you ready to spend another 338? I like all of the ideas. I want to find a way to make this happen. Am I ready right now to commit to another 338? No, not yet. One of the reasons, though, is because I know, if I'm reading what you're saying correctly, you are very confident that that number is coming down. So I want to hear more about how is it coming down, where is it coming down from. I imagine there are some things you can't talk about, whether it's collective bargaining or others. So I'm trying to choose my words carefully right now. So that's where I'm just trying to think through the best way to do it, because I fully support the idea. I think it's a no-brainer that these are legitimate things you want in the budget. I wouldn't even begin to debate that in any other direction. Is there a way, Bob, do you think, certainly not tonight, but in some short period of time as we're still having these discussions, that there would be a number that you felt comfortable saying, again, nothing's set in stone, but I feel comfortable that we can deliver on $100,000, $50,000, $10, right? Is there a number?
Yes. John and I will need to talk in terms of what we say in March, but what I said last night, and I'm happy to repeat tonight, is the town is prepared easily to set aside $100,000 worth of its planned spending and not do it.
Okay.
So there's a start.
All right. So I hate to just keep running the math, but now we're at 238. The math is important.
Well, let me point out something that's really important for you all here and why I made some statements I made last night. I had two choices to make. One is one I made. The other is to bring in the police chief and the fire chief and explain to you why we need another $300,000 urgently. Is that the kind of town and this kind of budget discussion you want to have? No.
Nope.
Exactly.
Eric is next.
And I think building on that, two options are, we agree to the 338 up front, or take this other approach. I'm not comfortable with the 338 up front. I completely share the concerns about the precedent and the complexity and all that. I really do. But I'm not comfortable with the 338 right up front, because I feel like it puts FinCom in a position to make a judgment on policy. I completely get where you guys are coming from. I get it. You're saying that's the most important thing, and I take your word for it, but it puts us in a position almost to validate that. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing else to put it up against. You could very easily come and say, I need three police officers. I need I'm not comfortable with us being in the position to make a decision on policy. That's not our role. I would be uncomfortable with 338 based on financial conservatism. That's not what free cash is used for. I'm hesitant to have FinCom put in a position to make a judgment on policy. What I think that this alternate approach does is puts it back on the town manager and the school committee and the administration to make those decisions on policy. Where
together.
Where can we find some of the stuff you have in mind? It was mentioned last night, you know, the 20,000s, the 10,000s. I know you've scrubbed it, but you're in that position and not us. That's why I would lean toward the second approach here.
Yeah. Elaine, you've been very patient.
So just one comment. The when we talk about the override and that failed and people said no, remember, that was $7.5 million. We were asking for $438,000. I just want to make sure we understand, and the motion that the school committee approved the other night basically said we wanted to collaborate with the selectmen, and that we wanted to obtain a commitment from them that they would put an override on the ballot in some time frame before we reach a budget cliff that none of us in this room want to imagine at all. But I still feel like we have done. This is my at least 10th school budget. And we have done everything that we possibly can. I don't think we can commit to saying we're gonna be able to come back in March with some new thing that we missed. I think that what we're talking about here is going to take more time. That's why Bob has this as phased forward, because there are processes and then even the things that typically we would get a variance on during the year, we have to be in that cycle to see those variances. So, you know, I'm not saying that the school committee is not gonna look at it again.
Yeah.
I'm just saying but
I don't think anyone is asking you to find something between now and March. We know it's not there.
But
what
Mark asked Bob, he was trying to pin Bob down on a number.
You're gonna continue as you run through the course of the year.
Yeah. I'm saying no. Bob brought something up last night, and so I think that was
And I thought there was a discussion that there in fact were some smaller things that might be possible. But whatever the discussion was last night, I'm going to ask that we do look at it that way, because you know, you've heard from some people, if the notion is kind of it's 338 or bust, that may be a tough road to go from what you've heard tonight.
But it is, because we need the seven teachers. You realize this is, that's the model.
I've got it completely.
Okay.
But what I'm suggesting to you is that if everything is kind of locked down already, you know, you've heard the opinion so far. So my suggestion would be we got to work with this process, see what's going to be possible, do exactly what you said, which is work with the selectmen. The override, you know, I'll go crazy for a second. The crazy side is you need an override this April. That resolves it too.
Which won't pass, but okay.
But long, there is a short-term solution is interesting if it leads to a long-term solution. Yeah, we need a long-term solution to get played out. We need to figure out what can be done to get ourselves toward that.
We tried to bring a solution, what we brought, not what Bob and John and Gail and has transpired since last night, but what we, the committee, brought was a solution that we felt was in the best interest of the district and the students and provided the highest probability of success.
I think we need to see what we can accomplish in the next few weeks when it comes to the actual budget that comes here, so that we can. Go ahead, Jean.
I was thinking about what Eric said about establishing policy, about FinCom being in that position, and for what it's worth, again, another thing about that makes exceptional, and the reason we're focusing on them and not all the other cuts that we would desperately want to fund but are not asking for funding, is the, I keep saying systemic, but the systemic destabilization of these cuts if they were to be restored in a year. And to your point about, I know there's a desperate need for firefighters and I know there's a desperate need for police officers, but those strike me as more like our high school teachers or elementary teachers, where at the moment the funding comes in, you do that hiring and you get them in and you start to build up the capacity again. The middle school cuts are different. Once you've cut them, you've really messed up a kid's progression in a way that will take a couple of years, and you're going to lose a whole several grades. So that's just something to consider.
I have no reason to doubt it, and I trust you guys' judgment. It's just more a matter of principle that I'm concerned about here.
I hear you.
Actually, can I do it, John? Then, okay, John.
No, I have, now I have a clarifying question because I'm a little confused. I've heard two different things in the last minute and what, for March, we're supposed to be doing. So we're going to present a budget to you. And I heard at one point, no list, and then I heard another point, a list.
So what I heard last night, good opportunity to clarify, was that Bob said there are some opportunities to not spend, change policies, and it's order of magnitude 100,000.
Well, I think he was talking about
on the town side.
The municipal government budget.
Right. So was there not a discussion that I heard from last night?
Absolutely not.
Okay, then I'm wrong.
Okay.
I stand down, and
I'm just going to jump in. I know Elaine has said this, but if you want some fun viewing, go watch the school committee budget meetings. You are correct.
Did you say fun viewing?
Very fun. The level of scrutiny that this budget got, there wasn't a question we didn't ask. There wasn't a line item we didn't look at. So I think your caution is right. Are we willing to engage in a collaborative way and do our best? Absolutely. But I agree with you. For us to sit here and say, I think we're going to find a bit.
There's just not a lot there.
The other challenge, which is a little bit different from the municipal budget, is that we have less expenses and more personnel costs. And most of our expenses are mandated expenses. And there's very little discretionary left in those expenses.
Things like insurance, legal.
Right. Special education, tuition, those things. So to say we can offer X, Y, and Z, I don't think it, based on the month that the school committee has just gone through the budget, I don't think it's feasible.
Yeah, no, I've attended four of the meetings, if I'm not mistaken. So
yeah.
I was there. Eric, you were. Oh, sorry, Vanessa. Sorry.
Thank you.
Right direction.
Thank you. To Eric's point on policy, I think in my mind, it's not my reservations about the approach of looking forward is less about what the money is being used for and simply the fact that we are postponing that expense. It could be for fire, it could be for library, it could be for senior services, it could be for teachers. To me, what it is being used for, while I understand the need for this particular decision, that is absolutely within the school committee's realm, and I don't question that need at all. My concern is simply the postponement of that budget need. I have a quick question regarding for a selectman meeting as well. Regarding how deep the cuts and how narrowly this has been used as far as every single line item, I absolutely believe that. And what that says to me is that with setting aside the cuts that can be made on town manager's side, there is very likely to be a need for some amount, whatever that amount may be, down the line if we take the approach of pushing it ahead as opposed to dealing with it up front. Because we know that there's nothing else that can be cut. I've stood outside the superintendent's conference room during some of those meetings and listened in. I know there aren't any more places to cut. So that means there absolutely will be a need for some amount. Whatever that dollar amount is to be determined. And then, has the Board of Selectmen discussed an April override? Because it was discussed very theoretically at the financial forum.
I think an override has been discussed. The need for an override, I thought, was made very clear. I think the selectmen stated that. In terms of the timing, however, I don't think any decision has been reached.
No, it hasn't been, but it would have been last night. The selectmen were prepared to call for an April override. When I say prepared, I don't mean absolutely going to do it, but they were mentally very engaged. A month ago, maybe not so much, because they see the urgency. Quite frankly, the grassroots in the community said, we're not ready. We can't organize. We can't support it.
Mm-hmm.
So the selectmen last night said, okay,
mm-hmm.
you're not there, we're not there.
Okay.
So, and, you know, they had the same concerns the school committee has expressed. You know, what's changed in 6 months? Why are we doing it so fast? You know, how are the no voters going to have changed their mind? All right, so there's some people that didn't vote, they'll vote. You know, isn't this too fast? But they were ready to do it because they do understand the urgency.
the mechanism I came up with allowed everyone to take a deep breath, take a step backwards, deal with the difficulties that exist, but at least not this one, and sit back and say, what's the best approach to have a successful override, albeit for a shorter amount of time, not 7 or 8 years or 9 years, but let's really sit down, think about this, and organize it. And Selectman has, you know, started to discuss mechanisms. I showed him some thoughts last night of more detailed ways to give real information, not conceptual information. It's very difficult for all the complex budget stuff to be boiled onto one page. But one thing I know did not work well was the idea of buying the time. A much better way to do it, and I designed an April override if they needed it. A much better way to do it is to say, for instance, and I'll just make numbers up, the school department gets 500,000 in year one, 250,000 in year two to either add or avoid cuts, depending on how things go, and 250,000 in year three to either add or avoid cuts. And that's that future money that we just described as future money. We didn't actually assign it to anyone, but we could have. We could have said, you know, 64% of this money that's being set aside belongs to the schools in future years, not in year one. So there's much better ways to describe the override in a soundbite, if you will, than we did.
By the way,
last
I want
year.
That spreadsheet, though.
Yeah. Elaine, first, then you.
I just like a process question, because there's so much dialogue, but you, and about sort of what we proposed, but we haven't even presented the budget. It does seem, I think it's good to have the dialogue, but we're sort of having the dialogue in front of us.
Absolutely.
Actually doing the proposal.
Absolutely.
So.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Sorry,
okay.
And hopefully that was the idea of kind of send us some information, let us do some processing. And you know, same thing here. We all were exposed to this idea last night, right?
Sounds like a disease.
I hope that's not the case. But it's going to take a little bit of time, and one of the reasons why we felt it was important to meet tonight was because there was a lot of bubbling, obviously, going on in terms of what's happening and how do we think about it. But hopefully this also gives us a little bit more time before we have to review the budget and have to bring forward something to town meeting with a recommendation. And then town meeting has to be able to absorb what we give them and then make their decision on what's going to happen. So there's still a ton to do. Let's go to Eric and then come to Bob.
So on process and next steps and all that, we talked a little bit about we'll get a budget with two numbers, the 25,865 and the 41,301, right?
Yeah.
And beg pardon, but this is my first time through this. What a year to join.
Thank you.
Timing is everything.
Well, you started with that dumb.
Wow.
That's right. It's much more fun than firearms. When we get those numbers, what do we get behind that? Do we get unit level stuff, or do we get what kind of detail?
Historically, the schools have given out a budget book and a
units
report.
You'll get the
school
committee budget book.
Right.
So when you add up all the numbers that come up to this, will it add up to 438 more than these two numbers?
Yes.
From that
actually,
book.
Actually, 588 more.
Yeah.
Because that is the budget that the school committee.
That's what we meant by the seven FTEs are, 438 is not in there, but seven FTEs are.
Correct.
When you look at the detail,
well,
there,
in the budget the school committee voted, everything is in there.
Right, the town manager's budget.
But
is
in
be.
My version of it, I can't balance their budget. It's inappropriate.
But
I balance the bottom line.
Okay, so when we add up the numbers, it will differ from
yes.
the bottom line.
Yeah.
That was presented.
Yes. And that's not uncommon. This year is a lot of attention to it, but it's not that uncommon.
Okay.
And to answer your, I think your other, you will also get the Munis printout.
Great.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes. And you'll get the 53-page question document.
we've been there for some of it, actually. Mark, you had a comment.
Yeah, I just wanted to do just one thing about FinCom policy, because I feel like we get feedback from the various parts of town, right? And I don't have anyone in front of me, or at least not yet, saying we need more police officers, we need more firefighters. But we do have a lot of people coming and saying we need to fix the school piece. So I feel like we're not making policy, so we're not coming to the school committee and saying, hey, would you like more money? We can recommend that, but, and I know we can't actually codify that, but we can recommend it. That's not what's happening. It's the other way around. And so I don't feel like we're making policy based on that. So I just wanted to throw that out there. And you can, yeah, sorry.
Peter, we haven't given you a chance to chat. Do you have a comment you'd like to make?
Yeah, I've been listening to it, certainly. And, you know, if the plan is to go to an override, I really don't have the issues with the free cash and then being a one-time item. But I just worry if the override doesn't happen. I mean, okay, you got a lot of people that are saying we would have voted for it if we understood. So you're liable to have people that said we would have voted against it if we understood. So, you know, you don't know how it's going to come out. And that's what I really worry about. Okay, we gotta get the money in now. Next year, if we don't get the override, those positions are all gone, and then some.
Yep.
Yeah.
That is correct.
A significant then some.
I don't want to leave it on that. Someone's going to have to make another comment.
Tell us more about the science. They make Adam.
How about those Patriots? Yeah. David, go ahead.
Yeah, so it's basically just to, unfortunately, I have to build on that. That's what I originally was going to ask. Hypothetically, if assuming the override doesn't happen, and the savings that you're thinking of, I think we came down to 238.
Keep talking.
It sounds like a catalog.
But if we don't find those savings, so two options, but for the future, for next year's budget, what would have to happen?
If the override doesn't happen or doesn't pass?
If it doesn't pass and we don't find those savings, what happens?
We will be looking at cuts of this magnitude and much more.
For next year?
Yep.
FY19 you're talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then we have another problem for FY18, which is to balance the budget. We have to make a choice whether we fund it through free cash or... What did you say, Bob? You would do.
I sent it right on a check.
I heard something about your wallet.
We're not going to generate enough more free cash to really fix the problem.
Right. So there are a couple of pieces on that.
Buy cars, excise tax.
Yeah, excise tax.
Yeah,
actually,
excise
that's not doing as well
idea.
As it was. Right. So again, then I'm going to give it to Bob for a sec. This was kind of day one. To read this proposal to understand it a little bit better. In the coming days, we need to dig into it a little bit more and understand more about it. Think, hear what some of the possible activities are, see if that mitigates this number or not in our minds, and decide kind of how we're going to approach it as far as the budget's concerned and presentation to town meeting, and be comfortable with it, right? That's our job, is to understand it and to basically bring it forward. So I think that's kind of some heavy lifting to go on in the next, you know, several weeks, and certainly as we vote on hear about the various budgets, 1st, 8th, 15th of March. So that's a good couple weeks away. Sorry, Bob.
I just wanted to clarify that never in my proposal did I imagine that the school committee would be coming up with money in the next month. I mean, what I said that the town could identify some purchases that we intended to do, some programs that we intended to do, that we'd be willing to give up for a year and do it in a future year, obviously at an expense. And, you know, Gene Browski asked last night, I can't remember your exact question, but my answer was, yeah, at some point, no, you can't have any more money from us. I would not hire a police officer or whatever.
Yep.
So, you know, this is not the... not the goodwill here.
My concern was the cultural impact of one side feeling like the 2/3, 1/3 split has always protected you're valuable, we're valuable, there's no fighting over resources, and this could create that dynamic.
But both the superintendent and myself, while not in a position today, will be in a much different position in the fall and then in the next spring. Hopefully in a better one never knows. If
if I have turnover that I don't now today know about next fall, there's going to be some period of time there's an open position, most likely. I can't tell you about that money today, but by November and certainly by April, I could. To Vanessa's point, that is absolutely correct, that that would have been free cash in the future. All you're doing is moving it up to that month. So there's no, like, long-term repercussion. It could have been free cash on next June 30th. Instead, we need it now, so it's not going to be. We're going to use the free cash now. If you will, you know, it's not giving money in the future, using it today. So, you know, you got to really think about it. It's not really a shell game. It's just a timing issue. I have extra that I don't know what it is, and I'm not going to give it to the end of the year. I'm going to give it to someone else. That's all it is.
And I go one step further. We actually do exactly this activity every November at town meeting.
Right.
We look at other needs and things, and instead of money returning to free cash, we allocate more to the fiscal year. We say we're spending more. So it's a regular practice that town meeting sees and votes on.
Yeah, and we get new revenues, new growth, state aid gets adjusted. There's all kinds of adjustments all the time. The schools normally don't participate in that. That's just
in November. Yeah.
In November.
Yeah. Linda, you're next.
I was just going to say that I'm comfortable with, I know it's not for me to decide, but with the description that we've had about going for the money if we can't, if it doesn't generate in other ways in November. My question is that, and it's, I've been a proponent for the April override because I feel like we know there's a need. Everybody's feeling the need. There's the energy now. I didn't actually hear the same thing you did, Bob, yesterday about not being able to organize for it. I thought that the plea was for, if we're going to do it, for everybody to get behind it to enable it to happen. So if there is a discomfort with looking forward for it to be paid backwards, then I hate to see March 1st, 8th, and 15th write off the opportunity for that override, because the deadline for deciding for this, and it's in the sandbox of the selectmen, is February 28th. So if they're going to decide to go for an April override because, and that's what you're more comfortable with, then I would encourage us going for it, because even if we, that, because that gives us the timing we need to reassure our teachers that they have jobs. And if they don't have that, they're going to be looking elsewhere. Because right now, they don't have any security. The middle school teachers I'm talking about. I'm not going to bargaining. I'm talking about the middle school teachers.
I just think they're, unfortunately, already looking.
She said they were already.
Already.
Well,
Bob's proposal is that that was the one piece of your proposal
it gives them security.
It's a promise.
That's the most
right now. It really
right.
does.
Right,
right now, it says we're gonna
will find
to this,
a way.
And I
and
said
they don't have to look because they're looking now.
Right.
Springs
and
opens in March.
What I was saying is that I like Bob's proposal and I'm supporting that, but I'm hearing some concerns about that, and if those concerns take precedent, then I would encourage going for the money earlier, because the April election's earlier than town meeting, and there might be more of a chance of acceptance, the positive vote from the override, than there would be for town meeting. I also had another question, and it, given how much time it takes for town meeting to decide on commas, I think I know the answer. But we're dealing with how we approach this funding, whether it's before it's allocated or afterwards, if we need it. Is that a question? And in my mind, what town meeting's discussion was about, and that they didn't like being backed into a corner. Is this a choice that town meeting might have a say in?
Absolutely.
Which way we approach it?
They vote the budget, absolutely.
That was actually, that was what I was just tapping you. That was going to be my point. making sure I understood it correctly, because I know we have said, all right, we don't want town meeting to feel, to your point, backed into a corner that, hey, the money's already been spent, now we're going to ask you to approve it. There really isn't much of an option here. But the way we go through the budget process, they will know that going into the budget. A budget will be presented for town meeting to approve. During that process, they will understand that there is a number, I'll go away from my 238, 438, whatever that number is.
Going the wrong way, wrong way, wrong way.
They will be perfectly aware that that number exists and that every effort will be done to mitigate them. So just as we're talking through it, I'm starting to say, okay, the town meeting certainly shouldn't feel backed into a corner or blindsided, right? They will be voting on that up front when we vote on the budget, and that started to solidify for me as we were having the discussion.
Right, the same clarification we got tonight is what?
Yeah, they will have that up front and ahead, so.
And they would have the opportunity to.
Yep.
To vote.
Just have a different opinion, who knows which way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but they'll have the chance to have that.
They could offer an amendment that would, you know, would allow for the free cash to come in up front if that's what they thought was appropriate.
Or cut the budget.
Or cut the budget, they would have our opportunity to make those.
It is their call at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Or grow the budget.
Either way.
And it's always their call if they, down, you know, a few months later, if we're taking out free cash, that's their call.
Yep.
I would be concerned with the fact that it's taken us approximately an hour and a half to understand and grasp this concept. And then to put this, I think the entire, correct me if I'm wrong, the entire purpose of FinCom voting on these items is to provide town meeting members with our opinion, because we are the ones that understand these numbers at a much more detailed level. And so, as I interpret it, they're looking to us for guidance.
Mm-hmm.
So if we present them with, I mean, I guess we would have to vote on which.
We'll have to figure out.
But in fairness, right, exactly. Came out last night, so it's a little hard to, we don't have any detail behind it yet other than the concept or where it may come from or how, and there may be some more that comes.
Yeah.
So a good thing about our meeting tonight is the opportunity to kind of to listen, to start thinking, to figure out what it might be best portrayed as. Bob, sorry.
No, just that point that you're going to hear more in March.
And as we go through each section, that's where we balance,
I wasn't expecting
right?
that you'd all walk out of tonight going, that's perfect, that's right.
or the opposite. That, oh, forget it, can't do it.
Yeah.
We'll see. You may be exactly right, but let's see. Let's give it a little time. Eric, go ahead.
I don't want to blow it up. What happens if we don't have a quorum?
At town meeting?
I know what the state does. I think the town is the same. You institute last year's budget 1/12 at a time each
month. Oof.
Oh my God.
But then you can only do that if you have the quorum.
No, you can do that without town meeting.
Say, so,
I'm
sorry,
sure.
Sorry to get said again. Sorry.
I'm pretty sure that you can institute last year's budget 1/12 at a time each month until you approve a new budget. I'm not positive. I know that's what happens with the state.
You mean
so I'm kind of hoping and guessing there's a mechanism for the tax.
How many people?
Oh, that would be really interesting.
To reach the quorum.
97. Yeah.
97?
Yeah. So before you do that, one question. Town hall's closed tomorrow.
Right.
Friday.
Right.
Saturday. Sunday.
Yep.
Open on Monday. Tuesday is the deadline.
But friendly reminder, you can show up to your precinct meeting, right?
I mean, there's
right, there's write-in opportunity.
There's write-ins, or you can show up that day and be voted in by your precinct. There's oodles of opportunity.
Monday is an important day on that. Linda, you had a comment.
No, I was just going to ask, you pretty much asked, I wanted to know if people are interested in running for it, how do they do it? How do they get onto town meeting now, given there's only 2 days to do it, Monday and Tuesday? So do they just go to the town clerk and sign up? Or is there an election piece of that? I mean, that's signing up to run for.
There's a form they need to get, and then they need to go get 10 signatures.
And then come back
if they're thinking of doing it right now, it's pretty late.
Right, or
but the point
you can
is,
have a write-in.
No, there's another process to it.
Ten's doable. But
you gotta get it Monday.
I'll sign it.
So Monday, yeah. So
Monday,
if you want to be on town meeting, get your forms.
The other option is you just get a write-in campaign, you hand out stickers, talk to the town clerk first, because there's a procedure for that.
Why can't you have to hand out stickers?
I said there's a procedure for writings that you can hand out stickers to voters, and they can put a sticker on a ballot, but that's gotta be.
Yeah, even easier than writing.
Easier than writing.
Sticker.
And that's another way to get elected through a write-in.
Cool.
Is there any absentee voting for town meeting?
No.
Oh.
No, not remote either. That's where you use that idea.
Ouch.
I would like to sincerely thank the school committee for coming to these meetings and giving us these explanations and giving us the time to explore these options in greater detail. I know that once we reach the stage of the budget presentations, there's not a lot of room there for discussion. And so I really appreciate all of you being here and engaging with us during this process. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you. And we certainly appreciate the work you're doing. I know this isn't a brutal year. So
and
thank
room
you.
Is really
it's yeah, it is pretty.
Save some money to the heat down.
Yeah, seriously. We just found another $50. All
right.
Add it to the list.
Any other comments on this topic for a second? This way, I'm sorry.
Okay. Oh. Just to give opportunities. I just want to add, so the school committee voted a budget that was different from the, so we all have our budget books that we poured over, but we added to that by keeping the seven teachers. That has created a lot of additional work for our administrators and particularly Gail. So
who started 5 months ago?
Yeah, she just she's
winning
it
with the
yeah.
timing.
She's with you, Eric. Right. So I just wanted to say that she's working as hard as she can on that.
Yeah.
And we'll and
as soon as you can.
Just,
understood. Yeah.
So
yeah.
I know you guys have been at our meetings, so you know we have the budget book, but you need the updated one.
So it's good to know you start at 5 a.m. though.
Right. So you'll actually publish it.
The charts will look different. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. And push the changes are getting pushed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You want to please send us the right stuff as it is. There are other things that are on this list that I think we will save for our next meeting. But just kind of put them in people's heads. There was a discussion about stabilization funds. Either Paula had suggested perhaps a certain amount get allocated to the general stabilization fund. There could be additional stabilization funds created. I think that's a subject for kind of a future meeting, to do that. At the financial forum, some questions were brought up in terms of RMLD and the formula and how that works. If I remember correctly, I think I might have been on a committee 5 years ago that looked into this, 5 or 6 years ago, whatever it was, to just understand what it was. We probably should understand it again. And what I was going to suggest is at our next meeting, we talk about maybe a subcommittee gets put together to start a dialogue with RMLD and see what's going on, just to understand it better, and then we can come back and help inform selectmen and others. Revolving funds, and we need to find a better way to describe to the community how they work, and the description of increase and decrease is a big fail. We just need a good term to describe what it is. We increased the offset in the fund, which lowered the number.
That's not perfectly sensible.
Well, I think the other thing we wanted to look at is the school budget. So we'll get to it when we review the school budget. It does seem like there should be some type of scientific algorithm, and that's probably the engineer in me, but to understand what the right offset should be based on certain variables on a certain account, because it's been difficult to get to the right number on offsets, and as it's hurt the school budget significantly this year. So what is the best known method for coming up with the appropriate offset for a given account?
I know Sharon had been working on that very hard, and I know now with Gail also, in terms of trying to wrangle these things and get them to, first of all, appropriate levels, but then second of all, making sure that they're managed right. So maybe we want to have that discussion with them and dig into that. But again, kind of a future topic. And then last one on my list was just the accommodated costs and reviewing what's in there. Is it right? Should it change? I've heard discussions on ambulance fees. I've heard discussions on out-of-district placements. Is it kind of roughly where it ought to be, or is there something that should be done? And I think, maybe I'm hearing things, but I thought Bob and John said they were going to talk about that this summer. Am I hearing that?
That's a topic we were going to look at this summer.
You busy this summer?
Okay, okay.
We're hoping a little less busy.
Good.
You go on vacation together.
Yeah.
I want to go too.
There you go, there you go, there you go.
I'll take a cruise.
There you go. We're next scheduled for March 1st, if I'm not mistaken. I think what we had talked about at one point is if there's a need for us to meet sooner, obviously let us know and we'll have that discussion. But other than that, I think we would save things for March 1st. Okay, any other topics? Got a motion maybe?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Got to do a roll call, sorry.
Oh, shoot. We really do, don't we?
Yeah.
Oh.
I accidentally disconnected.
Okay.
8-0 disconnect. Thank you, everybody. I think this was probably a really good meeting.